ولن ترضى أنت اليهود ولا النصارى حتى تتبع ملتي. صدق الله. صدق الله العظيم. Mr. Chairman, and my dear brothers and sisters, at the outset, I don't really have to apologize. It's no fault of mine that quite a lot of my brethren, they were not permitted to get into the Lawland of Holland Center. One of my dear brothers, one of Mick Mugudu, he tells me that the police kicked him, arrest him, take him to prison, all that kind of thing. That brother, I mean, everybody is complaining, but I can't offer what I'm offering that brother in particular. You know, the one who told me about the police kicking him and, you know, wanting to take him to prison. I'm offering that brother a videotape of the Royal Albert Hall lecture, absolutely free. Please, you know, I want you to give me your name and address. You know, if you'll just put up his hand, then my son is here. You give him the name and address. That brother was telling me about the police kicking him. Which brother was that?
There.
Yes. Let me give you the whip now. You can buy the horse later. The reason for all that turmoil was that the hall was booked by the Christians. You see, it was booked by the Christians because they had challenged us. And when they challenged me, I said, now look, you challenge me, you go and book the hall. Then I will come down. In other words, otherwise you can get every type of puppy, you know, little dogs, Pekingese, everybody wants to challenge the man. So you can say, I challenge Kamal Didat and, you know, I took him to task. I said, no, if you want to have that privilege, you must pay the price. So the guy agreed. Now since he agreed, he paid the price because the tickets were in his hands. They were supposed to give us 50-50. Half-half. But the guy didn't play the game. We will not do it. But in the future, I assure you that we will not go to the Royal Albert Hall anymore. That's finished now. No more. It's too small, we have realized it. So either we go to Wembley Stadium or to the exhibition hall in Birmingham, where I'm told that some 20,000 people can be accommodated inshallah. The topic I have chosen for this evening's talk is the challenge of Islam. This is a Christian publication. The title of this book is The Challenge of Islam. That is the topic for this evening's talk. In the verse that I read to you from Allah's Kalam, Allah gives us an eternal reminder about our relationship, the Muslims' relationship with the Jews and the Christians. There can be no mistake about that. He's telling us in the clearest terms, he says, وَلَمْ تَرْضَىٰ أَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَلَمْ نَصَارَىٰ that the Jews and the Christians, Allah says, will never lend. I understand in Arabic means a double negative. Will never be satisfied with you, O Muslims, unless you follow her brand of religion. And I don't know whether you know that if you choose to opt out because of murder, if you want to join the Roman Catholic Church, the Anglicans won't be satisfied. If you become an Anglican or any other Protestant church, the Jehovah's Witnesses won't be satisfied with you. If you become a Jehovah's Witness, the Seventh-day Adventists won't be satisfied with you. They have a thousand different churches and denominations, and each and every one, he makes you believe that he's on the right and even the Christians are all in the wrong. See, the Roman Catholics say, we are the true Christians, the original church. Peter, the first pope, he started it. And all the others who call themselves Protestants have protested away from the true path. So the Lutherans, the Anglicans, the Methodists, the Presbyterians, and a thousand different churches, they have protested away. So they are out of the faith of Christianity. But they tolerate one another when it suits them. But in the heart of hearts, in their minds, they do not accept the other as one of themselves, like themselves. So they will never be satisfied. No matter what branch you follow. If you choose to this, that, anyone,
the other Christians won't be satisfied with you either.
And this has been from the very beginning. From the very beginning of Islam, the Jews will tell the Muslims. Allah says in his Quran, so وَقَالُوا, and they say, لَنْ يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَ هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارَى. That you Muslims will never, again double negative, will never enter Jannah. There is no Jannah, there is no heaven for you, there is no paradise for you, unless you become a Jew or unless you become a Christian. This is what they have been posted. They're telling the little Muslims. They said, you follow this man only, illiterate person, he doesn't know how to read or write. You follow him, you'll go to perdition, you'll go to hell. You want to go to heaven? The Jew says, follow us. The Christian says, you want to go to heaven? You follow us. In answer to that, Allah says, تِلْكَ أَمَانِيُّهُ. This is the wishful thinking, vain desires, hallucination. You say, Bakwas, blah, blah, blah. Don't be afraid of that. قُلْ, tell them how to do it. So produce your evidence. إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. If you are speaking the truth, let us have a look at your Qur'an, your proof, your certificate that sends you to heaven and destines us to Jahannam, hell. Let's have a look at your proof. And they have produced the proof. They have produced the proof in 2,000 different languages. Do you know that? The Bible. In 2,000 different languages. She said, my Bible says this, my Bible says that. My Bible says this, my Bible says that. They have 11 different Bibles for the Arabs alone. Did you know that? I was thinking that there was only one Arabic language, the language of the Quran. That's what I thought. And I thought all the Arabs speak that language. But now they are telling me, I've got samples here, of 11 different Arabic Bibles. Dialects, script, types of writing. Oh, there is an Egyptian script, Egyptian Arabic. Then there is here, it says Tunisian script. It says here, Al-Karshuni, for the Syrian. There's Algerian colloquial, there is Tunisian colloquial, there is Egyptian colloquial. I didn't know all this. And there is the Moorish colloquial, and there is the Palestinian, and there is the Southern Sudan. For everyone, a different dialect, different Bible. So you Arabs have no excuse on the day of judgment, as the Christians feel. You can say, Ya Bari Tala, for these Arabs, we gave them a Bible in their own dialect. Whatever dialect they want, we gave it to them. And the guy still didn't pass them to the fall, sent them to hell. No excuse. Now, when Allah Bari Tala commands us to prove, it presupposes that when proof is produced, you will be able to analyze it. Otherwise, it makes no sense. When Allah tells us, demand proof, and the guy gives us proof, we must analyze it. We are not going to solve it. So they produce the Bible in 2,000 different languages. 2,000 different languages they can use the Bible. Proof. My Bible says this, my Bible says that. Now we analyze it. This is how Allah is commanding us to analyze it. When you analyze it, you find they haven't got a leg to stand up. And it is so easy, Allah, it is so easy to reveal yourself. On this basis, the basis of the Quran, Allah says, demand proof. Let's see the proof. And he hasn't got what he's telling you. It's not there. He's programmed. See, we all get through programming. It's a natural thing. You know, from childhood, my two new cousins, they program the little children. This monkey is our God. This elephant is our God. This handsome man is our God. This is our Rama. This is our Krishna. This is our Sita. This is our Hanuman. This is our Ganesh. They are programmed. And as we grow up, we will start cringing for these images. Programming. We can laugh at it. So how can human beings in the 20th century go and stoop down before these things? No, we can't. Program. So the Christian also is programmed. From childhood. Father, Son, Holy Ghost. See? He's programmed. He believes that Jesus Christ is the only begotten Son of God. Begotten. Says Adam? Yes, the Son of God. In the Bible, God has got sons by the tongues. But no, Jesus is not like that. He was begotten, not made. Adam was made by God. Jesus was not like that. He was begotten. Begetting is an animal act. It belongs to the lower animal functions of sex. How can we attribute such a quality to God? But they are. So now the Muslim, Islam is the only religion which comes into conflict with Christianity from the point of view that Islam claims to correct, complete and supersede Christianity. No other religion does that. The only religion which tells the Christians, look, this is not right. You mustn't eat the pig. It's not in your book. Jesus has never had it. That's true. He's none of his disciples ever had that stuff. Jesus went and killed 2,000 pigs one day. You know, we believe that when he's coming, the second coming, he's going to destroy the pig. What destroyed the pig? He started it 2,000 years ago. He killed 2,000 one day. Just like that. What? If it was a good thing, would he have done it? If it was an edible stuff, he would have done it. 2,000 pigs one day, he destroyed in the Bible. So he said, don't eat the pig. Don't drink alcohol. Don't be promiscuous. Don't gamble. Every step, we are contradicting the Bible. Islam has come to correct, complete and supersede. The Hindu will tell the Christian, say, look, you keep to your religion, you keep to mine. You be a good Christian, I'll be a good Hindu. He'll tell you the same thing. He said, look, you be a good Muslim, I'll be a good Hindu. Alright? Don't leave me alone. The Jew says his mind is his own business. He said, look, he's not interested in converting anybody. He's made his religion a racial religion. You have to be born a Jew to be a Jew. They don't want converts. Because the whole world, them are going Napak, Khalif, filthy, dirty people. Gentiles. The whole world. They don't want the Gentiles, the rubbish, to come into the religion. So they make the religion a racial religion. So Islam comes along. Rabbi Tala has given us this deen. He's telling us that he has given you a deen. Leaves the hero of all that deen and kulli. That it may prevail, overcome, and supersede every other deen, every other way of life. Judaism, Christianism, Communism, every ism. Islam is destined to master them all, bulldoze them all. This is the best of Islam. The role which we are experiencing, where they are making inroads into our community, where they are stealing our children, where they are using us as doormats, as punching bags, going to make nests in our head. That role is our choice. This is not our destiny. Destiny Allah gives us this is deen is to master them all, bulldoze them all. Wallahu kari al kafirun. Say, now my Muhammadi unbeliever might not like it. Wallahu kari al mushrikun, another place. Say, now my house Muslims might not like it. And he repeats the same formula again in the Quran, three times in the Holy Quran. He repeats the same formula. He said, Huwa allazi arsala rasulahu bil huda. He is who sent his messenger with guidance, with haq, and with the religion of truth. That it may prevail, overcome and supersede every other deen. وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا. And enough is Allah is a witness to this fact that is going to make his deen to prevail with you of doubt. This is his promise. This role that we are now experiencing is our choice. It's not our destiny. The destiny is Islam to master them all. So Islam is a challenge on all sides to everyone. Last and final revelation of Allah Ta'ala, Ta'ala, most perfected deen, as he says, Al-Yawma Akmaltu Lakum Deenukum, says, this day I have perfected for you your religion, Wa Akmamtu Alaykum Ni'mati, and have completed my favors unto you, Wa Raditu Lakum Islam Adina, and I will that Islam should be your religion. But, nothing to be added. There's a need of you. He's given you a deen, perfect deen, and it's a challenge to the whole of mankind. It's a challenge to the Hindus, to the communists, with the atheists, with the agnostics, with the Christians, is a challenge to everybody. More especially to the Christians. Because once these lands in the Middle East were all Christian lands, this city was Christian. Lebanon was Christian. All these areas, you call Jordan and all these little bits, all was Christian. Whole of North Africa was Christian. All Christian land at one time. And when Islam comes on the scene, bulldozes them all then. And change them. Then they are Islamites, Muslims. It's a challenge. Once Christian land, they have lost it. Then they conquered our land through superior power. They rule us. They rule us for 100 years in India, Pakistan, Indo-Pakistan, Japan. They rule our Indonesian brother for 300 years. They rule Mozambique.
500 years.
500 years. Muslims in the Muslim country. Did you know that? Even today, 60% of the people in Mozambique are Muslims. Did you know that? When the Portuguese, 500 years ago, when they were finding a sea route to India, for our spices, they were finding a route to India, they knocked hells into our blood because of the superior weapon, and they conquered this place called Mozambique. Mozambique was, it was a Muslim territory, there was a Muslim governor, an Arab. His name was Musa bin Baik. Musa bin Baik. The Portuguese couldn't say Musa bin Baik, so they said Mozambique. And it just stuck. Mozambique, he said Musa bin Baik. The Jabal al-Tariq, they couldn't say Jabal al-Tariq. Tariq was a Muslim commander who crossed into Spain and they burned the boats. They burned the boats. So it's Jabal. Jabal means mountain of Tariq. Jabal al-Tariq. They can't say Jabal al-Tariq, they say Jabal Gibraltar. Manila, the capital of the Philippines, Manila is Ma'amanullah, with the help of Allah, they read there. Ma'amanullah, they can't say Ma'amanullah, they say Manila. Muslim. We are a challenge. And in South Africa, this book is written, The Challenge of Islam in South Africa. There they found that we Muslims, we are there for 300 years, the first group of Muslims, that touched that those shores from Indonesia. You see, when the Dutch, Holland, when they conquered Indonesia, those of our brethren who were fighting for their freedom, the heroes, the freedom fighters, they were captured as prisoners of war, and they were shipped to the Cape of Good Hope, and sold to the white man as slaves. Then when the British conquered Malaysia, those people were fighting for their freedom. They were captured as prisoners of war and shipped to the Cape of Good Hope and sold to the white man as slaves. Good Hope for the white man. It was Good Hope for the white man. And for 300 years, they have been hammered to Christianize. 300 years. After 300 years of hammering, the Muslims there, whom we call Malays, it's a wrong term, but we call them so-called Malays, inverted commas. These Malays are one of the most militant Muslim communities in the world. After 300 years of hammering, they became hard as steel. Amazing. The same period of time, when our African brethren from the West Coast were taken over to America, and they were 100% Christianized. These Muslims, they fought back, and they became one of the most militant Muslim communities in the world. So, for 300 years, they tried. And they have multiplied. The Muslims have multiplied. Beyond natural multiplication. Beyond population, we multiply. And we are a challenge. They uproot us from one place to another. They uproot us from our settled homes, our Juma Masjid. Take us away out into the jungles, into the wilderness. And then we put up our own new habitation in 11 mosques in Chatsworth. 30 mosques in Lodium, in the Transvaal. You uproot us, wherever you uproot us, we pick down again our masjids, taking down, so, right, we'll be there, inshallah, until Yawm al-Qiyamah. We are a challenge. In a foreign environment, the government is in the favor, financially, they have everything, missionaries by the thousands, and they have not been able to work with us. We are a challenge. This is what the guy is telling us in the book. Same thing here. You are here about 100 years. The Muslims. You are numbering today, some say, about 2 million. In the UK, 2 million. And you are a challenge. You are a threat. You are a profanity. Look at this masjid. In the heart of Britain. Look at this masjid. Look at this guy. Wherever you go, you're begging it down. Begging down. Masjid, masjid, buying churches, buying synagogues. Huh? You are a threat. Crying out. Yeah. This is the Christian publication. Islam comes to Britain. I showed it to our doctor, Muharram. I don't know if I'm mispronouncing his name. You know, our director. I call him Muharram. You know, I don't know. I'm mispronouncing his name. Forgive me. Forgive me. So I showed him this. He said, this is our masjid. This masjid. This is the minar. This is our masjid. I said, yeah, but you didn't publish this. This is the Christian's problem. Islam comes to Britain. For what? He says, look, it's a threat and it's an opportunity. The Muslims are a threat and an opportunity. Yeah. England, he said, the Muslims are coming. The Muslims are coming. In order that the Turk is coming, the terrible Turk. I don't know how many Turks we have here. Only Turks. So the terrible Turk. You know, the Turks are coming. They have to put their children to sleep. I said, the Turk is coming. So the children go to sleep. This is the terrible Turk. Now the Muslims are coming. But this time they are very happy. They are afraid as well as they are very happy. The missionaries are very happy. They have changed their headquarters. International teams. They were in Canada. They had the headquarters in Canada. From Canada, they made the center in Birmingham. Why Birmingham? It's the center of the UK. Huh? And they say, I must read you exactly what they say. Who's making the mouth water? Get a mume pani ata. Mume pani. You know when you see some nice food, your mouth water is making the mouth water. Say, our goal, our strategy. Our strategy. There's some Pakistanis sitting there, Muslims. It says, our strategy, our goal is to field an English speaking team to Birmingham to work amid the 25,000 Bengali Muslims. Why Bengali Muslims? Because they are humble, poor people, illiterate people, maybe more so than the Pakistanis. With apologies, I don't mean anything, sir. You know, the conditions from which they come, overpopulated and misrule for centuries. They are coming from there, maybe a little poorer in education and in money than maybe the Pakistan. See? Or the man from Hyderabad, Dhaka. Better education. So Bengali is making his mouth water. He's mocking the Christian mouth water. What an opportunity. Now they say, the Christian. They say, you see, we have 5 extra advantages against the Muslims. 5 advantages they have, which they didn't have before. Number one, he says, you see, previously we had to go out 5,000 miles, 10,000 miles away from home. You know, they are used to this life. They are used to their comfortable homes. From here they have to go to a foreign land, away from a home base. Now, these people are coming. So we can work from a home base. You can sleep with the wife and children, and in the morning we can get started going and knocking people's doors, or we can work till late at night, and we can sleep with our family. You are now working from a home base. Previously, 5,000 miles away from the home base, 10,000 miles away from the home base. See now, one advantage. Number two, say culturally, the people, where we went to in Africa, or Bangladesh, or Indonesia, culturally, they were very, very backward. We had to sit on a grass mat on the floor, and the flies are buzzing around us, and the smoke is coming from that kitchen of yours, that chimney, you know, smoke is coming, he's smarting his eyes is watering, his nose is watering. Now, culturally, you have sofa cushions, you know, nice sofa, comfortable lounge suite you have. And you have a nice dining room table and a chairs all around it. Look, casually. Look, this guy is ready to receive us. You don't have to go anymore to Bangladesh and sit on the ground. Or to Indonesia and sit on the ground. Comfort. These guys have already prepared for us, for our needs. This is sofa cozy. So, we have an advantage. Number three. When we went out in the past, when we went out in the past to do our missionary work, linguistically, we have to learn the language of the native. You go to Bangladesh, you can speak English with them, they have to learn Bengali. You go to Pakistan, you must learn Urdu. You go to Indonesia, you must learn Indonesian. You go to Zululand, you must learn Zulu. Now, these people are speaking our language. You are making an effort to learn his language and speak as good as him or even better. You are learning his language. You've got to. If you want to survive here, you've got to learn his language. So
So linguistically, he doesn't have to go out of his way.
Look at the advantages that he has now with you. Then, previously, if a man was converted in one of the villages, in India, Pakistan, anywhere, that man stands like a sore thumb. Everybody says, put that dog in him. You end up killing him. He's, apostate. He's left Islam. You know what goes through your mind. You see that Muslim brother of yours. Who was your brother? And now he's a murtad. He's an apostate. He's a kafir. How do you feel? So everybody, as soon as a man is born, they say, you know how you feel. Killing you. Now, isn't that guy becomes a Christian? Here, 60 million so-called Christians. He can become one of us. No trouble, no worry. So now, you are not one in the minority. You know the minority, you become one with the majority. Number five, says the governments of those countries, though they're doing nothing to stop the Christians, like in Pakistan. Pakistanis have been perverted into Christianity since independence than in the previous 100 years of British rule. More Bangladeshis have been perverted into Christianity since independence than in the previous 100 years of British rule. But the people are not happy. The governments are not happy. Though they are not putting any obstructions in the way, they are not happy. Here is our government is happy. Take them in and follow them, digest them. These are foreign elements, foreign way of behaviors. Make them one of us, make them all big eaters, make them all to drink wine, do better business. Can you see that market? And his students are coming, brainwash them, convert them. So, perhaps it's not working. It's a challenge. It's an eternal challenge to the Christian. We are an eternal challenge. You are a provocation. The very fact that you are a Muslim, it's an insult. The very fact that you are a Muslim is an insult. You wear a topi, you are an insult. To them, maybe we also feel it that way. So take it away. Put it in the pocket. Yeah, you are an insult to them. You are provoking them. Even with this, previously we used to give you the red dress, the Turkish dress. I used to wear that, like a Turk. We had a brigade, called the Muslim Dad's Brigade. Everybody wore the Turkish dress. We call it Turkish dress. The red topi with the tassel. Yes, but now even this humble thing, we are terrified of. we have lost our identity. We have lost the Sikh, a handful of Sikhs compared to us in India. There are 15 million Sikhs. Those guys with the turban and the hair comes out and goes back into the turban. Look, we must take our hat to them. What luck? They have an identity. They identify themselves as a Sikh. He's proud of being a Sikh. We are ashamed of being a Muslim. Yeah. You don't have to wear anything provocative, but this humble thing, even this you are afraid of. You know what? Inferiority complex. You know what this can do? This is one of the most potent weapons. Yeah, this. This piece of cloth. Huh? Most potent piece of cloth. In India, I'm telling my brother that if you wear this, 120 million Muslims, you just put on this. It boosts your morale. It will boost your morale. It's like 90 million so many Muslims. It terrifies the enemy. So many Muslims? Huh? In India, in our country? It terrifies the guy out of his wits. And our Nabi Kareem, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he thought of this psychology. He said for Eid. Eid ka, go to out of town. Don't you? Therefore, here is difficult, but you can go to Haifa. Haifa, yes, Haifa. Or somewhere else. 10,000 people, 100,000 people. Go to Ika. Why Ika? He will take mention of it. What they will do? They will not go make salah. No. If the woman goes, in any condition, she goes, the children goes with. Now the enemy is watching. What? So many Muslims? We didn't know. And the Muslims, we didn't know there are so many. Boost your morale, and terrify the enemy. You terrify, that's the psychology of Eidka. But no. We don't want to go out. You say, yeah, maybe people will see us, they're doing monkey kicks, going up and down. You might as well, enclose. That's beautiful, must it, yes. But how many he said, go to Eidka. What for? Psychology behind it. Even menstruating woman, you say. What for? There's a psychology behind it. It is you
power. You see your brother, so many. Terrified the enemy. In India, I went to my country. I was born in India. After 50 years, I returned to see. And there is a town from where I come from called Surat. Surat is above Bombay. It's a small port where Arab traders went, you know, to barter the dates for our Muslim cloth, our turmeric, our tamarind. And we came into contact with them and we became Muslim. My people are still. In Surat, when the British were ruling, any time there is a trouble between Hindu and Muslim, we had Muslims who were Urdu speaking in Gujarat. They speak Gujarati like me, but also their home language is Urdu. They said there were old soldiers left to the Turks, you know, when the Turks conquered the place. And now said, now we are those remnants left over, so they speak Urdu. We speak Gujarati. He also speaks Gujarati, as just as good as us. But his home language is Urdu. We call them Miabais. No insult intended for anybody. This is how we call them in the record. We say Miabai. We are Boras. We are the Sunni Boras. Boras, Boras, we are. So these Miabais, they were a military compared to my people. My people were farmers. You know, they're humble people. These Miabais, any devil starts in no time. No problem for us being the villages around Surat, no problem. The Miabai does the job. The Miabai does the job. In the military problem. Yamaro, Yamaro, Sarayda, Dial, you know. This is that spiritual type of problem. More like the Pakistani. So I go after 50 years and I can't see a single Miabai. Not one. What happened? They don't want to be recognized. Why? Why you're terrified? Of the Hindu, you don't want the Hindu to recognize you. Psychology is, he does the job. You did it for that. Your mind is already gone now. Finished. You're terrified. Because you're not identifying yourself, you're terrified. If I identify, maybe you just might start some trouble, or maybe they might not hire my taxi. So he does the job. And the Hindus are telling two things you must do to these Muslims in India. Two things. Number one, dissuade them from using the Muslim name. That's very easy. Very easy. Dissuade you from using the Muslim name. You go for a job, what's your name? Muhammad Sadiq. You see now it's full up. Maybe some other time, maybe if there's something I will write to you. Ahmad Didat. Didat can pass. See, this is a Hindu servant. We have Hindu servant. Originally, we were Hindu. You see, we retain the servant. Ahmad is Muslim. No chance. So I go, try one place, another place, another place, I'm getting here, making a headway. So I said, no, man, maybe it's a name. So I'm Dida, I'm Dida, I pass. But Ahmad, so look, man, do something with Ahmad. Maybe I can get a job. See, I thought, they said, this way you from using the Muslim name. Number two! Dissuade them from wearing a hijab. They're telling you. Dissuade the Muslim from putting on an identity. And you did it voluntarily. Voluntarily. They didn't say anything. You just did it. What they want you to do, you did it. So 120 million Muslims. No, say, you are worthless, not what happens in that country. A handful of Sikhs. Indira Gandhi was bending backwards to appease them. And Rajiv Gandhi gave them everything they wanted except independence. We Muslims, we can't even cry in that country. You know that? We can't even say, why are you hitting us? An average of 2 riots a day are taking place against our people in our own motherland, and you can't even cry. Why? You lost your identity. Who made you to lose it? You did it yourself, all of you. No, these are little things. Little things. I'm not telling you, Muslims put on a turban or put on a red face and provoke people, you know, like the red rat to the bull. We don't want you to do that. Something humble. Sikh has got an identity. That identity is in power. He is like a lion. He like sheep and goats. Emasculated animals ready for slaughter. He can go up to a Christian type, you can question me, and you can take me to task. Even afterwards, I said, look, uncle, I think these are all fibs, false stories you're talking about. I said, look, this is what I am. This is the reason. If you have a head here, you see a man in the streets, assalamu alaikum. I have been traveling, this is the 7th trip of mine to the UK. I have been traveling in the underground. often.
And I see a man across me. I can't start a conversation. You guys have asked him, where you come from?
You people are saying, is that your business? Do I owe you something?
But if you had something on, say, Assalamu alaikum,
wa alaikum salam.
Say, where you come from, Ahi? Say, I come from Morocco. No, 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 mashallah. You're from Africa?
I'm also from Africa.
I'm from South Africa, you come from North Africa.
Mashallah.
You're from Libya?
No, mashallah.
Here you come from. Immediately, you're gonna do it. Once you're a Muslim,
he's an open society.
Assalamu alaikum,
his heart is from open.
Where you going, brother?
Say, I'm doing so and so. And I'm looking for accommodation. I'm looking for a house. I'm looking for somebody who lives in stone. Come, I'll take you and show you.
I want to go to the masjid. So if I see somebody in the head, say, excuse me, Assalamu alaikum, masjid. He says, come, come.
I'll take you.
Otherwise, I don't know who to talk to. Identity.
Oh, that's one point.
So we are an offense to the Christian. To everybody. That's it. So either we give in, subject, join them, join them. If you want peace, join them. Or you change. And this is our destiny. When Allah says, he's given you a deen, that is the master who can supersede them all, rules them all, not with a gun, even if you had it. Even if you had the laser gun, you have no right to force Islam down anybody's throat. Allah says, like Rahmatullah, there is no compulsion in religion. It's worthless. If you have the power and you force people to accept it, it is not worth anything. It must be a voluntary acceptance. Become your brother. So, intellect, Allah has given to us. There is not a system that you can't deal with on that level. Intellect. The Christians, they have now started new systems, new techniques. When I was here at the Islamic Cultural Center the last time, I spoke on the subject man and God relationship. How many of you were here? Please put up your hand, I have an idea. Not many. So whatever I might have said, it bears repetition. If the 50% of you put up your hand, I said no. It's not fair to start, you know, pushing the same thing down, repeating it, but I think it bears repetition. You see, how I got started with this, people are asking me, how did you get to, what do you know, how do you know all these things? So I didn't go to any university, to any Darul Uloom, no. They asked me where, I don't know, when I went to Malaysia, you know, at one of these training colleges, they asked me to go and deliver a talk. So the chairman, who was to be the chairman, is asking me. He wants to introduce me. He said, which university you went to? So I said, I went to the University of Hard Knocks. He said, where? I said, it's all over the world. Now he still didn't catch a joke. He still didn't catch a joke. He's not used to that type of language. We are used to it. So he's introducing me. So Mr. Dida went to the University of Hard Knocks in Durban. So the Hard Knocks were Hard Knocks. You see, after leaving school, I started working in a country shop away from the city. And this was a Muslim shop. And across the valley from where the shop was, there was an American-born mission, American mission. And they were training missionaries. Yeah, in South Africa and Natal, outside Durban, training missionaries. And these missionaries, whatever they learned, they came to experiment on us in the shop. He said, you know, Muhammad has so many wives. I said, I know nothing about that. No exaggeration. I knew nothing about that. He said, you know, Islam was spread at the point of the sword, in Muhammad forces religion down people's throats. He said, if you don't accept Islam, chop off your head. I knew nothing about that. He says, you know, the Quran was copied, Muhammad copied the Quran from the Jews and the Christians. I knew nothing about that. This is the only thing I knew about Islam was that I did the Kalima, I'm a Muslim. And if I met any of you then, and you said you're a Muslim, he said, yes, I said, read the Kalima, the Shahada. Read it. She said, I said, you pass.
That's my test. It's like a magic formula. If you can say that you're a Muslim, if you can't say that you're not a Muslim. That's the only thing I knew. I knew how to do Salat. The way my father did wudu, I did it. The way he made Salat, I did it. The way he passed it, I passed it. That's what Islam I knew. I knew nothing. These guys are telling me, using the Prophet, using Islam. All the other staff, they're all school boys, all cheap labor, you know, just at school, everybody, me and all the others. And we are utterly helpless before this Christian mission. So either leave the job and run away, or you fight back. But you can't fight back if you have no knowledge. You need weapons. No weapons, no knowledge. And jobs are hard to get. You can't go and start looking for another job. You can't. There is So Allah is Musabbibul Asbab. He is the creator of opportunity. If he wants to help you, he opens the doors, as his promises. So وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَهُمْ جَنَّةٌ سُبُلَنَا. So whosoever strives in our way, we open up doors. Pathways, open up. So I had a hunger for anything, really. I had that. Bulk of the Muslims, we have got it. We are an Iqra community. The very first word of the revelation Allah gave over Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was Iqra, read. We are all in line Iqra community, people who don't read. We don't read. But somehow I had this and I couldn't afford to buy books. So I was putting newspapers. Old newspapers. When I read it, it's new. Whatever I read, it's new. The 6 months old, year old, if I read it, it's new. Everything is new. I read. So one Sunday, we don't work on Sundays. So I go to the boss's warehouse and then I see a pile of old newspapers, and in the newspaper I'm rummaging for some better material to read the newspaper. Like a magazine. We have magazines like the Outspan, Farmers Weekly, Personality. So anything like that is preferable to that old newspaper. I'm rummaging through. And while I'm rummaging through newspapers, I come across a worm-eaten book. Reddish in color, full of mildew. I pick it up and I start to sneeze. I'm not sneezing now. I start to sneeze and I look at the book. It says, Izharul Haq. I-Z-H-A-R-U-L-H-A-Q. Izharul Haq. It's written in Latin, which is English. It's good. Izharul Haq. Izharul Haq. Sounds like a Muslim. What is this? I don't know, but it sounds like Muslim. In the book, it's written in I-Z-H-A-R-U-L, but it sounds like Muslim. So I see at the bottom in the small letters, it says, the truth revealed. I said, maybe it's how it means, the truth revealed. So let's have a look. From the book, I'm reading. It was about the British conquest of India. When the British people conquered my country, they felt that at any time, anybody will give them trouble, it will be the Muslims. Because power, rule, dominion was wrenched out of the hand. And once you have tasted power, you aspire to get it back once more. This is human nature. You tasted power, you want power once more again. And the Muslims were a militant people. From the Hindu quarters, there is no fear. Because they were as docile as the cows that they were worshipping. Allah is very kind. Not now, they changed. But they were as docile as the cows that they were worshipping. So they felt that if they can convert the Muslims, they can rule India for 1,000 years. Just change the people, teach them to turn the other cheek. What Jesus said, that you slash in the right cheek, give the other. Teach this fellow to do that. And you can rule India for 1,000 years. So they started pouring in the missionaries like frogs in the rainy season into India. And they started challenging the Muslims to public debates. At first the Muslims were reluctant for two reasons. Number one, the British have conquered us. If you see something and fight that too strongly, they might send us to Calabar, Andaman Islands. You know, like in South Africa, they send to Robben Island. So they might send you over somewhere to Calabar, in the Bay of Bengal, this Calabar, Andaman Islands. They're deporting all kinds of dangerous characters there. No, I send us away there. There is thing to cover the way. Number two, he says, the guy challenging us in English and we can't speak English. Good excuse. Our allies said, we can't speak his language.
How can we debate with them?
So they mastered our language. The missionary. And this is the genius of the Westerner.
Wherever he goes, he learns the language of the native. Wherever he goes to Indonesia, he learns Indonesia. He comes to Zulu land, he learns Zulu. He goes to Basotho land, he learns Basotho. He goes to Swati land, he learns Swati. Wherever he goes, he masters your language. He goes to the Arab countries, he learns your masters your language.
So he masters our language. And he challenged Muslims in
Delhi to public debate.
Now, what excuse?
So Maulana says of Delhi, Dehlavi, he accepted the challenge. The young men stampeded him, said, come on now, you must talk in our language. How can you say no?
So he accepted. And according to the appointed time and day, the debate starts. And I'm told in the book that 100,000 people gathered in India here. And there was no mic system. I don't know how voice travel in those days. But you get to chat, it's precious. You see your view, then, this is a little tiny thing, you know. It happens, somebody passes, hey, you know, good look.
You Mara also, Masha. Maybe he creates his own story, you see, but what's going on there? He's commenting on what's going on there.
So, according to the appointed time and date, the debate starts. And Reverend Founder was the guy from Britain, from your country. He speaks in Urdu, ke Maulana Sahib.
Get the debate started. Shuru kijiye.
Get started. So the Maulana says, look, you are our elder brother. Christianity preceded Islam by 600 years. As such, you are our elder brother. And according to our culture,
you have the first preference. Number two, he says, you are our guest.
No doubt an unwelcome guest. But a guest at that. And according to our culture, Hamara Nirvan,
first Reverend Kuto,
yes.
So as such, you get the thing more started.
Start the talk. So the Reverend begins in Urdu. He says, Maulana Sahib, where is your Prophet Muhammad?
Nah, this minute, where is he?
So the Maulana thinks for a moment and says, he's in Jannatul Firdaus,
in heavenly places, with Allah by heart.
Out of that answered him the second question. He said, all right. Tell us now.
Where was he when his grandson Hussein was martyred at Karbala? Where was he then?
So the Maulana again talked for a moment and he said he was still in Jannatul Firdaus
in heavenly bliss with Allah by Ta'ala.
Out of that answered him the third question. He said, all right. If he was with his Allah, as you say, when his grandson Hussein was martyred at Karbala, then he asked his Allah for help.
So, ya Allah, look at my grandson, they are butchering him, they're killing him, please help him out.
Then he asked his Allah for help.
And there was a long pause. So the reverend started speaking speech. So, come on.
Then he asked his Allah for help.
He said, you have a big brother, somebody's bullying me, and I have a big happy brother there. I said, look at this guy, he's taking unfair advantage of me, please. Not come to the rest of
you. Why should that?
So, Allah Bari Ta'ala is there, Prophet is there,
won't you ask Allah, what's happening there? Karbala, please.
Didn't he?
Can he speak? So the Maulana said this, he did ask Allah for help. It's a natural thing to do. He said, what did he say? What did Allah say? Because you know he wasn't saying all this is going on in Urdu. What did he say? And there was an inaudible pause, a very long pause.
And the man who could hold his started standing, he said, come on, what did he say?
And everybody said, the Maulana and Maharaji.
The Maulana got us all, you know, booked up.
So the Maulana starts. He said, Allah cried, Allah is worthy. So, Allah cried.
He said, Allah cried. He said, I couldn't save my own son, Jesus. How can I save your grandson? And the debate was over.
You see, it has nothing to do with truth or falsehood. Nothing. It is matching of the wits. You know, it's a wit. There's a saying that twice armed is he whose cause is just. If your cause is just, you know, you give it
double spirit.
You know, you can stand for it. You're going to fight it. You're going to prepare to die for it. But thrice armed is he who gets it first.
that I will not give you the whole flow. You finish.
Now my children are right.
Useless. So that's what I knocked about. I'm reading this in the book, which makes the book interesting to me.
Then I read about an Arab chef.
An Arab chef. You know, a little ruler, something like a little emirat. He's a little ruler there.
And a Christian missionary got stuck in Tunisia. And they have a persistence. We have an eye of mine.
They'll never let you go.
If you give me a finger, they'll catch you by the hand. They'll never let you go. If you call him in, he's not going to speak to you, give him tea and samosas and bhajas, they'll never let you go. Until one day he says, hey, keep out of my door. I'll put a knife to you.
Or you get put out. Either way. Otherwise, there's no way of keeping him out.
There are procedures.
We have a quiet. You know, we have an argument and we beat the fellow. And they're satisfied, I beat the fellow.
Why don't you persuade? Find out where he is. Why don't you invite him home?
No, I beat the fellow. And knock him out.
That's our mentality. That guy, if he makes a little crack in you,
no hope, no chance for you until you are converted.
So, this Christian missionary is making hell for this poor share.
Christ has been sins. You know, God Almighty, he came down to earth. You know, he has such compassion and feeling for mankind. You can't make the grave. So God himself must come to earth and he must die as a man to redeem you of your sins. That God Almighty, he died for you. He died for you.
This is the only thing he can give you. And he's telling them, believe. You don't have to pay back that today.
Winter and summer, passing full month, winter and summer, killing yourself, going to a desert land. Perhaps you don't have to do all that, straightjacket in your life.
No, you just believe that Christ died for your sins and salvation is yours.
If it was true, because all of us have tried, you know, what a fantastic way. You don't have to do all this. What we are going through.
God Almighty, he gave his life, his son is himself coming down to earth in the form of a son, and he died for your sins.
There is no way out for the push. No doubt. He is not equipped, he is not to the arguing debate.
But this guy is pushing him day in and day out, every day, to rescue himself.
He had a brain.
So he tells his secretary, his prime minister, he said, look, next time this guy comes along, whisper something in my ears. Just whisper in my ears. So the guy came this morning, and this secretary, as he was told,
and the sheikh started to cry, like a woman. Mother, I died. Oh, my God.
So the priest wants to know what happened. The missionary wants to know what happened.
No. And his mother has died.
Come.
Please, I can sympathize with you. God, what has happened? He said, this is not the sad news. That Achim Jibreel, Jibreel
died.
Gabriel, he died. Achim Jibreel died.
So the priest said, see, not angels will die. So he said, are you fool? You tell me that God died? Now I'm reading this in the book. You see, I'm reading all this in the book. So I'm sitting there in the boat house, you know, in the warehouse, on the floor, in the dust. I'm reading this, I can't let go. About Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, about this, this one is that one is that. So, when I had a chance, I go to Durban, I go to a secondary bookshop, and I find a New Testament. I bought for sixpence. That is a small piece. We had a smaller piece called Tiggy, three-penny piece, in silver, look at silver. And a little bigger, sixpence. So I bought a sixpenny New Testament. That's the start. So, I go back to the study place. Say, Matthew, I look for Matthew. Mark. This one called the mission, Mark, so and so. I'll find that. I'll mark it at this page. You'll find the contradiction there. This one is Luke, contradicting John. Then he says, I did, so and so. I did. So I look for I did in the Bible. And I don't, I did means do to say. If it's Matthew, then it's I did means the same in Matthew. But I don't know what it means. I did, I did, I did. So, I look for IB in the Bible. I can't find IB. He says, no. So now, I'm getting armed. I know something about the Bible. I mark it. So now when they come to do the Bayan, I say, where are you going on Sunday after church? And I said, no. So where do you live? That's right. I'll come and see you. Sunday morning 10 o'clock. Right? So I go. I said, now look, one point you give me in the favor of your religion, I give you 10 against it. You give me one row, I give you 10. That's the only language I knew. See, I'm a school boy, just a school. You give me one row, I give you 10. Even I got to know. Kids now. See? Not with the faces, with the intellect. And every Sunday is a new onwards. Heart so present. It's so precious that I tell you, Allah, you know, I did boxes, and I know when you get the guy from the floor, when you go, he gives you some ecstatic feeling. I did wrestling, I did judo, I did weightlifting. Can you see the way I'm standing now? I tell people jokingly, don't make a mistake, don't try. Don't try. Then you're the old man, 68-year-old, so don't take a chance. So, you get that pleasure, holding the fellow over, knocking him over. Oh, how tasty it is. Then I go to Durban, that's right, I look for a bigger market. See, every Saturday afternoon, you close at 1. I have my lunch, and look for a church. Go to church, yes. I knock at the door, look for the padre, the priest. The father, you know, I'm very interested in religion. I would like you to come home and, you know, enjoy my meals, you know, bring the family along, and I want to share, exchange the word of God with you.
I go speak. To me, it's a pleasure. Get the guy to the house, and my wife will cook, you know, Mr. Jalda, you know, I don't know whether it's the sweet rice, and Soji, or Suryani, and they enjoy my food, and they say they enjoy my call. I give them a good fashion. Nobody ever comes back. They said they enjoyed the food, they enjoyed everything, but nobody ever comes back. For a second dinner, nobody. That's my hobby. And Allah says, woman ahsana qawlan man da'a ila Allah. Who is better in speech than he who is watching from Allah's face? Wa amila salihan, and is a doer of good deeds. Wa qala innani min al-muslimin, and he says, I'm a doer of Muslims, who has submitted the will of Allah. He is asking who is better than in speech than he who does this. In other words, there is nobody better in speech. The best speech making that you can do is to invite people from us. The best hobby, the best preoccupation, the best occupation is this. And my hobby has become my occupation. I can't imagine anybody having a better job than what I have. Oh God, there is it. My hobby is my occupation. It's a hobby. This is an occupation. So I started knocking people out there, everywhere. And the pleasure it gave me that now he's been with the Royal Performer. Once, twice in 5 months. Now the guy's challenging me again. I said, look, Royal Performer is too small. We'll have to go to Wembley Stadium or we go to Birmingham. This is the hobby. This is the primary occupation of the Muslim. Every Muslim, you earn your living by all means. Whatever job you do, whether you sweep, clean the toilet, there's no shame in doing any work. Any honest labor, no shame. But every Muslim must have a second occupation, and that is sharing Allah's deen with people. Udu ila sabila rabbika bil hikmah. To invite all to the ways of thy Lord with Mishnah. Wal mawa'idhatil hasanah, and with beautiful preaching. Waja'adilhum billadhi ahsan, and reason with them. Please, that are best. My brother and my sister, I said, there's a very easy way. Our name, our employers, our co-workers, invite them home for a cup of tea, and your puchas and samosas, and your jalebis. You know jalebis? You know this round thing? With the juice inside, sweet meat. Ooh. You know, I gave one to an Africana lady, she came, you know, I took her home and I gave her tea and jalebi. And she said, jalebi, you know this round thing? And she ate that. She's asking, how did you get the juice inside? She wanted to know how the juice went inside the jelly. They're interested. They want to know. How such lovely food. Our bhajiya, our samosas. I tell you, we can knock people over. You don't have to be very clever. Your dollar and rice is one. Dollar and rice. You say ridiculous.
He said, ridiculous. I said, no. Professor Germanus, professor of philosophy, he was converted by eating our dollar rice. Professor Germanus and Iqbal, Dr. Muhammad Iqbal, were studying philosophy in Germany together. Before Pakistan came to India, this guy, around the 40s, Professor Germanus visits India. That's a point. And he goes to Lahore, goes to meet his old friend Iqbal. He was a Friday. Iqbal is drunk. He reaches Iqbal's house. Finding out where he is, he reaches the home. And Iqbal and his friend are just seated at the, on the ground with that little sheet, and they're eating dal and rice with some chutney, chataka, some kachumar, you know, salad and things like that. Sat down. And he sees this, his friend there, the doorway, says, come, 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 man, come. He said, no, I had it. Come on, man, he said, come to me. That's Muslim hospitality. You said you had it. Now, my man, come and sit down. But I know, I'm here. You people in Britain, you have changed. That hospitality is gone out of you. You have become like the Englishman. See, the Englishman says, why did you phone me before coming? You say, my people are very hospitable in South Africa, the Muslim. But the same for when he comes here, you see, we have a saying in my language, that when you tie a horse with a donkey, the horse can't pray like a donkey, but he drinks of his head. Yes. घोड़े को गधे के साथ बांधता है तो घोड़ा ऊंची ऊंची नहीं कर सकता मगर सर ऊंचा करता है एंड माय पीपल माय ओन पीपल आई एम कमिंग फाइंडिंग आउट दैट दे आल्सो बिकम लाइक दिस डोंकीज दैट यू आर टाइड टू यू आल्सो बिहेव लाइक दैट यू वांट टू नो व्हाई यू फोन मी व्हाट ही सेड कम आह व्हाट एवर इज दे कम सिट डाउन एंड ईट सो ही सेड कम ही वांट्स कम कम जॉइन अस सो ही सिट डाउन टू ईट एंड ही ईटिंग व्हाट डॉलर राइस ऑफ कोर्स द डॉलर वाज कन्वर्टेड He's a bunny of food, my machine. And we are bunny of food, we're eating golden rice. Without meat. Now, you put meat inside, you make it Muslim. But putting meat inside. So, it's a very Muslim golden rice. Can you try this? So tasty, my mama. Our food is so tasty. It's so exotic. In my country, the African hawks it. You know, the white man hawks it. The color, there's no people there in the country when we give our food that he can resist. He eats and eats like a hawk. This guy, Professor Germanus, is eating, tasting the chutney and the machine. So what is this? He said, this is Lord and Christ, our staple food. So what? A nation that can change this simple staple thing like Lord and Christ into such an exotic food, what kind of a wonderful religion do you have? To accept that religion. That Lord and Christ, one word of the man. Sounds so silly. Foolish! He did it. People see our cans in the toilet and they get put. Do you know that? Can in the toilet. My secretary, from our masjid, from our office, we can see the Juma Masjid there. We can see the masjid. People come in. And he sees somebody around lunchtime, somebody peeping into the masjid, through the window. So he was going home for lunch, so he goes and walks up to the fellow and says, look, guy, you want to do anything? He said, yeah, I'd like to know a little bit about Islam. He says, look, I'm going for lunch. If you like, you can join me. And while we are at the lunch table, I can tell you. He said, all right, come. Take him home. And he goes home and says, excuse me, I'm going to go to the toilet. My secretary says. So he goes to the toilet, he comes out. So the other man says, Englishman, Hogan, Mr. Hogan, Englishman. He said, look, I also want to go to the toilet. No. He goes to the toilet, he comes out. He said, what do you do with the can inside the toilet? What do you do with the can? So he explains. And then you go for number one, you wash. You go for number two, you wash. What? He said, yes. You know that for good of the world. Hygiene! The topmost hygiene in the world! Another guy who converted, the Reverend James Campion, we call him Jamaluddin, his parents are still Roman Catholics, very staunch. And they always harass him. But he's a very patient young man. Jamaluddin Campion. You know, there was a lot of very young guys. He's Jamaluddin Campion, Englishman. So he also takes the can to the toilet. So the father is asking him, Jimmy James, what do you do with a can in the toilet? So he explains. Again, after a few days, he's getting impatient. James, what are you doing with a toilet, can in the toilet? So he says, Daddy, look, you waste 100 gallons to wash the can. With Harpic, you know, this disinfectant, to wash the can, make it clean, so you can stand. But he says, Daddy, you don't use one drop of water for yourself. On yourself, not one drop of water. The pan, yes, you wash. But not for yourself, not one drop for yourself. He goes and tells his wife,
German, his father goes and tells his wife, he says, you know, what Eugene says is true, but I won't admit it.
Wallah, it is so easy.
Allah, all of them, I say, all of them, whatever. What your prayers and samosas can do, you don't know.
It's half the battle. There is no better way to get into the heart of a person than to restore. Look, this is the example of an Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
It's sunnah.
Nobody talks about it. I haven't heard a single learned man talking about the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That when he was commanded to preach, he called the leaders of the Quraysh, invited them for dinner. And after dinner, he stood up to deliver the message. In among the leaders was Abu Jahl. And Abu Jahl means father of ignorance. He was no father of ignorance. He was the shrewdest of the Arabs. He was about one of the very few fellows among the Arabs in the time of our Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who could read and write. He was a rare fellow. His real title was Abu Hikmah, the father of wisdom. He is the father of wisdom. But our Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that with all his knowledge, if he can't see the light of truth, he is not Abu Hikmah, he is Abu Jahl. Therefore, because the light, his knowledge is not making you see the truth, so he is Abu Jahl, he is the father of ignorance. So that title was stuck onto him, that nickname. He was no Abu Jahl. He was Abu Hikmah, father of wisdom. Clever fellow, shrewd fellow. So he stood up, he said, you're going to listen to this youngster for this mess of 40 he gave you. Come, shh. He scattered them all. He scattered them all. Just like that. One devil can do this. He can take the whole thing for the rain. What does our Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He invites the leaders of the Quraysh. One more for dinner, minus Abu Jahl. Nobody talks about that sunnah. Nobody. He's telling you about the beauty of sunnah. I believe in all the sunnah. But nobody talks about this sunnah. Why? You know why? You will cost you something. That sunnah costs you something. The other sunnah costs you nothing. For me to tell you what you give a beer, what does it cost you? I say you must pray 5 times a day. What does it cost you? Nothing. But after taking local who cannot get out, feed people, call them home, feed them there. It's going to cost you something. I'm going to set an example and it will cost you something. So, best thing, don't talk about it. You do that. You follow that sunnah. The first sunnah of this propagation he did. Follow that sunnah. Call them. Feed them. Talk to them. He said, have you seen the Quran? Get a translation. Like this Abdullah Yusuf. I don't know if it's available tonight or not. They're supposed to be available. This Quran, Abdullah Yusuf. You know, almost 2,000 pages. 1,900 pages. For 6 pounds. 6 pounds. There is not another book in the UK you can buy 2,000 pages for 6 pounds. A 200 page book I will buy for 19 pounds. 19 pounds. Yeah. This is 2,000 pages for 6 pounds. Now, you owe it to yourself. I will make no commission on this. I promise you. No commission. You buy from any. Whoever has got it, you buy it. This book, what it can do for you and your children. This book, this translation is the only translation which gives you a verse by verse translation. It begins, for example, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Just opposite that. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, most merciful, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. So all praises due to Allah, the cherisher and sustainer of the world, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, most gracious, most merciful, verse by verse translation. So over a period, you can almost learn Arabic. That's how I learn. When I'm talking, I seem to understand what I'm talking, though I don't know Arabic. Simply because I've been using this translation. Again and again, again and again. So that constant repetition makes me to feel that as if I know. And I feel that I seem to know through that system. Number two, he gives you a commentary so beautiful. Allah is so beautiful. And his language is so good, as if it's an inspiration in itself, the language. The Westerner, you show him this, he can't believe that an Oriental could have written that. As if it's a new revelation for him, which is the English I'm talking about. You don't have to read Shakespeare or Milton to improve your English even. Then he has a very comprehensive index at the back. What do you want to know? Anything, everything you know about the Jew, when Israel, and Israel, when Israel.
You want to know about the Christians, you want to know about Jesus, you want to know about marriage, you want to know about divorce. What do you want to know? Whatever you want to know on your fingertips. You want to know about marriage and the age. You want to know about divorce and the scheme. Everything on your fingertips. That's it, you weep for yourself. And your children, you need. Your children need it more than anything.
If you, my address, if you understand Urdu better than any other language, as I get into Urdu translation.
You understand
Gujarati better than any other language, as I get into Gujarati translation.
You understand Bangladeshi better than other languages, as I get a Bengali translation. But in your home, in this country, if you want to live here, and if you want your children to live here, it is imperative that you get an English translation. Imperative.
Because without this language, you will not be able to present it to what it is. Impossible.
You might know Arabic. You Arab also understand Arabic.
You might know Arabic, you understand. Directly you imbibe the message.
Still not good. Still not good enough. If you want to be in this environment, if you want to share this message, you talk, you also mean the same. If you want to live in this country, you want to talk to the people,
you've got to get an English translation.
Improve your English. Improve your English.
And
you're using the right words, the appropriate words to convey the message. In your own mind, you know you understood, but now when you're going to start explaining to somebody, you can make a hash of it. You can murder the whole thing, the whole idea.
Get this, use it, all your neighbors, your fellow workers, open it, give them tea and cakes. Hajjaj and samosas, open the book. He says, you know what my book says about Jesus? No. Open the book, start reading to him.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, from Surah Al-Imran, that's chapter number 3, verse number 42. قالت الملائكة يا مريم, behold, the angel said to her, Mary,
you will say, you understand, you are, you know what I mean. This is when you say, the angel was telling Mary, that's a beautiful one. He said, no. Behold, the angel said to Mary, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاكِ وَطَهَّرَكِ وَاصْطَفَاكَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ الْعَالَمِينَ. God Almighty has chosen thee and purified thee, chosen thee above the human of all nations.
Yeah, what is wrong with thee? Devat thee, wasudhi, wadkati, vahdhati, so'ubhi. Worship the Lord and bow to me. Prostrate yourself and bow down my prayer to you, bow down.
Can you see the language? You're learning vocabulary,
you're learning the construction of sentences, and you're using the most appropriate words for conveying the message. On your own you understand, well, I know. You know, you don't need, between you and Allah there's no problem. But when you want to share, you need exact terminology. Right words, in the right place, and not, and well, you see, you know, the man is thinking that the Quran is being because you are being Don't bring this disgrace upon the book. Please use the exact language of the Quran, the way the man has taken 40 years of his life to do this job.
Use it.
With these words, Mr. Chairman and my dear brother, I am very, very grateful for the young man for creating this opportunity for me to come and share these few thoughts with you. May Allah reward them and reward you. Wa ta'ala alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.
Brother Ahmed, we can go on forever if you have time. We really appreciate the time you spent with us. But for the next 50 minutes or so, we'd like to invite questions from both brothers and sisters. There's a microphone upstairs in the sister section, and there's one on my left here for the brothers. If you queue up behind the microphone, we'll have alternate questions between the brothers and sisters. So if whoever has a question, please take advantage of this opportunity.
Call them Unitarians. They believe in the oneness of Allah.
But while they believe in the oneness of Allah, they think it is in the Bible, and which is so. The Bible doesn't teach Trinity. It doesn't. It doesn't teach the multiplicity of God. It doesn't. So they read the Bible and say, look, the unity is there, and it is there. It is in the Bible. So they feel they are still Christians. They believe in one Allah, but they still think that they are Christians. And there is no need for them to become Muslims. So our problem is that we should, these people have come so close to us. See? They reject Trinity. There's another group of people called themselves Jehovah's Witnesses. They say that God is one. God is not a triune God. That there's a secret. As soon as a person accepts what you say, we must congratulate the man. Now that is where you live in town. Agreement. As soon as the man says he believes in Allah, he says he doesn't believe in the Trinity. He doesn't believe in that Jesus is God. It's a congratulation. Look, our main problem is over with that person. The biggest stumbling block is the divinity of Christ, that Jesus is God, or the Trinity, three in one. As soon as the man renounces that, he's coming closer to you, accepting with open arms. And this is the secret Allah is giving us in the Quran. قل تلا يا أهل الكتاب وفيكم of the book تعالوا كم إلى كلمة سواء بيننا وبينكم. Let we come to common terms. Let we join as in you. Let us get on a common platform. And that's kalima. Get with the Jews and the Christians, bring them, all them, that applies to anybody, everybody. Get on to anybody, everybody, onto a common platform, a common agreement on anything. In this case, this is number one. Allah, na'budu illa Allah. That we worship none but Allah. Yes, he is in Allah. So now is a concept. In his concept, in my religion, he believes in one God. But who is that one God? Some of them might say that is Jesus Christ. The Hindu says it's Rama. Some says everybody says there is one God. Nobody says there are three gods. Even a Trinitarian, this is three in one. So once you find common ground, he has an opportunity to get started. The man says, I don't believe in God. You know, he's a very good customer. Did you know that? He's the best customer we have at the 80s. He's the best customer. He's taken the first step in the direction of Islam. He is nearer to you than the Jew, and the Christian, and the Hindu, the atheist. We say Kafir, the one who said, I don't believe in God, among the Westerners. I'm not talking about the Mushriks of Makkah. I'm talking about the modern day atheist. The atheist means one who says there is no God. That person, he is taking the first step in the direction of Islam. If you recognize him. But we don't. You're going to fight it, Kafir. You're going to go to hell. And a congratulations. It's amazing. This guy did that. He must be off his rocker. You congratulating a Kafir? He said, yes. So why? Look at him. I said, you know, congratulations. He's shocked. He's shocked himself. When I congratulate him, he was yesterday to fight. And I don't fight. I said, congratulations. You know why? I said, if you said you were a Muslim, no congratulations. You know why? Because your father was a Muslim, your mother was a Muslim. You are a Muslim, so what did you do? You were born in it. Did you, you deserve any congratulations for that? No. You say you are a Christian. No congratulations. Your father was a Christian, your mother was a Christian. Right, is it right? So what did you do? Nothing, you were born in it. But if you say you are an atheist, congratulations. He said, why? I said, you are thinking. What made you say there is no God? You are thinking. What are you thinking? You think from your background, your own experience, and your own experience was that in your own book, you were given a concept of God which was anthropomorphic, meaning thinking of God after your own pattern, that God is like a man. That's how you read the Bible. See, the Christian Bible, the first book, book of Genesis, it starts about the creation of Adam and Eve. We also have that story, but listen to this, I'm giving the Christian. That Allah Bari Ta'ala creates Adam and Eve, and he puts them in the garden. He says, in the garden, eat anything, everything of the fruits in the garden, except the tree in the midst of the garden, that tree, of that tree thou shalt not eat, because the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. Finish. And Shaitan made him face into them, and they act. And when they act, this was supposed to be the tree of knowledge, according to the Bible. So the knowledge came to them that they were naked. Prior to that, they were living in felicity, innocence. They didn't know that they were naked. Now they know that they're naked. So they started plucking leaves to cover themselves. And Adam heard the footsteps of God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. Boom, boom, boom. You know, the mighty king, come, boom, boom, boom. So he heard the footsteps of God walking in the garden. That's what the Bible says. Now, while I'm talking, you can visualize the scene. Monkey chant, millions and millions of times bigger than that. The earth must have shook. Boom, boom. So Adam put the footsteps and he hid himself in the bushes. God doesn't understand where Adam was a few seconds before. And he says, Adam, where are you? Look, this poor father doesn't know where Adam was. So Adam came through the bushes. He said, I'm here. He said, look, if you behave like that, you have been up to mischief. Why would you behave like that? You must have done something wrong. So you know what he says? He says, the woman that thou gavest to me, she made me to eat. You know, in other words, blaming Allah. If you didn't give me that woman, I would be in trouble. You are at fault. You shouldn't have given me that woman. That cow. Subhanallah. Our part. He says, is the woman that thou gave to me, she made me to eat. Any woman? He says, no, it's a serpent that guided me. Passing the buck. The oldest game in the world. Passing the responsibility to somebody else. But do you believe in a God like that? Do you? No. Same book, first book, Genesis. Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, he says, oh God, oh Lord, I want to see you. In the Quran, same request. Allah says, Lam darani, you shall never see me. He is insisting in the Bible, saying, I must see you, I love you. And sometimes we're not included, you know. They also want something that is not good for them. They do the same thing, so he's doing the same thing with Allah. Say, Lord, I love you so much, you know, I must see you. So Allah, I'll do you a favor. He says, I'll put you between two rocks. He puts him between two rocks. He puts his hand in the opening that Musa alayhi salam can't see. He said, he turns his back. Takes him in his hand and Moses saw the back of God. So he's got a back side. He's gone. He's going to have a front side. And it's too horrible for Musa to see. He could have fainted. So if God has got a back side and a front side, he's got a top side and a bottom side. If there is such a God, then you have a right to demand wanting to see him. A God with a top side and a bottom side, he must be located somewhere. So Gagarin, the Russian astronaut, when he went out into outer space and he returned after so many spins, newspapers of the world carry banner headlines in inverted commas. Where is your God? Where are your angels? Question mark. Gagarin. So I mean, the Christian missionary says, look at this. This guy is asking, wanting to see God, wanting to see angels. So he says, he's a fool. I said, no, he's not a fool. You are a fool. Is the concept you gave him that God told Father Christmas, sitting on some planet, with his feet dangling on the earth as his footstool, the heaven as his canopy, the loving Father in heaven, millions and millions of times bigger than man, or something like a man? Is the concept you gave him? Do you believe in a God like that? No. So no. You don't believe. So he doesn't believe. He doesn't believe in a God like that. So he has taken the first step. He says, La ilaha, there is no. First step, you have to say, what? La, why la? Yes. You speak in it? La, ilah, no ilah, there is no object of worship, there is no God. This is what monkey God? No. This elephant God? He says, no. This is woman God? He says, no. This is Jesus God? He says, no. The God that Moses and Adam saw in the garden? He says, no. The one that Moses saw in that side? He says, no. So, he's taken the first step. Making the saying of God. That's all. He said, La ilaha, shoot your congratulations. No, no. We have to learn with the Jew, with the Christian, with the Hindu, agnostic, anybody, everybody. This is a secret. Try and find common ground from where to start. And there is, if you put on your thinking, yet there isn't a person with whom you can't get started on that level. Whatever he says, try and find a common ground. Get off from it. Get off from it. Sorry, my brother, I'm giving you
this. This question comes from a sister who wrote it.
Really?
No, I can't read it. It's a little blind.
No. Urdu, quick. What
is
that?
It's in Arabic.
Arabic.
السؤال هل المسيحيين الذين هم الآن هم من يحل لنا أكل طعامهم وأن يأكلون طعامنا وأن يأكلوا طعامنا كما جاء في القرآن الكريم؟ She is asking if this Christianity who are living now nowadays or those people who they allow to eat our food and we allow to eat their food as revealed in Quran.
My dear sister, the Rodis, you see, my strength is
my weakness.
My strength is that I'm an expert in comparative religion. And I told you how I became an expert. This is my field. This is the matter of Sharia, the law of Islam. Sharia, you are the alim. If you doesn't know, replace it, get another one. This is not my field, please. You know, don't embarrass me, because I'm going to make statements here and there, and then you put me in a compromising position. You watch, I'm talking about comparison with authority. I said I'm an expert, and I am an expert. If you have any problem in that field, come to me, it makes me happy. Because when I'm explaining to this, I'm feeling that I'm shining before you all. This guy, I start answering, I start apologizing before you. Make me feel very small. Don't belittle me. Ask the chef and the imam. When the time comes, no, this is not the occasion. Right, any other question?
Assalamu alaikum. It's a delight, nice to have you here amongst us. My question is in a form of a little statement. A little while ago we heard your speech telling us that in your place, back home in Surat, there were a lot of nearby and people used to be proud of wearing this guy, I'm 21. And when you went back recently, you found that people didn't have their caps on. Because India is independent now, there's a lot of persecution going on there. Similarly, here in this country, there is a color discrimination. At worst, is the religious discrimination. And especially we Muslims. And especially,
I think the mic is not on.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam.
Simply for those people who have not heard this before, I was putting a question in a form of a statement that Brother Didat had visited back in India, his place where he originally came from. And people used to, in them days, wear this cap on their head. And there were some nearby the people who really fought and defended Islam. But then recently when he went back, he found that people weren't wearing this cap because India is now independent and there's a lot of persecution going on of the Muslims there. My question is this, that in India, there are many more Muslims than there are here in England. In England, there is a discrimination of color and there is a greater discrimination of religion. We have an Islamic education society in Hayes, and when I approach a government department for an assistance, they looked at the name of my letterhead, the Islamic Education Society, and they said, sorry, we don't give any help to the religious organization. Now, this society doesn't only propagate Islam, but it also does other social work for the community in that area. And the Muslims everywhere have their own social needs, apart from their religion. But they are thrown out of the window simply from the title. We also heard that in India, they are trying to dissuade you from using your name. The example was given. Similarly, there is an effort here also to dissuade you from using your name, to dissuade you love to use your Islamic name for the organization. Take out the word Islam completely. Take out the word Muslim completely. Become a youth, Asian youth. Right. Become an Asian youth organization. Then of course you will get all the funds. But that Asian youth may be controlled by the Muslim youth. I am asking Ahmadinejad to throw more light and tell us that how do we defend this identity under such circumstances.
Thank you.
You see, if as it is, you can't hide your identity that you are not an Englishman. Bulk of us. There are some of us might pass, but very few. You know, can pass as a white man. The white man in South Africa, European. So, in the very first group, you know that you are an outsider, an interloper. Now, religious identity. I said, look, suppose it militate against your job. In the office, if you wear this, the guy doesn't want you. You know, discrimination. You can keep taking off. But as soon as you come out in your own time, who's stopping you? In your own time, when you get into the underground, who stops you? So, the very fact that you find half a dozen people waiting around, walking around, the hooligans also won't touch you. Because, hey, this guy's, you know, maybe that will come to this, you like the sick. You see a quarter dozen sick, half a dozen sick. When I went to Hong Kong, I'm going through, I see a sick standing outside the bank with his turban and his uniform. I see another Sikh riding a bicycle. I see another guy riding a taxi. I see another Sikh walking with his wife. And it left that impression that there are many Sikhs in Hong Kong. But there were at that time 6,000 Pakistanis. And there was not one Pakistani that you can see. There were 6,000 Pakistanis that I found that were there in Hong Kong at the time when I went in 1977. But there was not one you can see with an identity. Not one of the Jinnah gang. See, so there it is. Now, who's stopping you in your own time when you leave your job? Suppose that's your job that you work, but I think that even at your work, if you put this on, there is a respect you do. I work for Jews, I work for the whites, and my identity created respect. They knew that this is Muslim fellow, he stands for the principle. In my country, if you're standing for the lift, you know, hitchhiking. If you have a head here, you will get a lift in double quick time. Because the person knows this guy is identifying himself, he knows where he belongs. Otherwise, we don't know what he is, a hooligan, a riffraff, a cutthroat, we don't know. So the guy passes you by. But you have an identity, immediately, almost immediately somebody stops, whether Muslim or non-Muslim, because you know, you are not ashamed of your identity. The guy gives you a lift. I feel trapped. And if they bash you on your head for that, all right, then put it inside your pocket. But I feel that nobody will. The Englishman, I find that he seems to be a very tolerant, generally, he's a very tolerant man. He is a very kind, hospitable man. I found him. Very cooperative. He wants a direction, the guy stops, all the other things, and he wants to go out of his way to show you. My people in my country, no white people ever do that for you. Again and again, one day we need about the help of about 8 to 12 white people wanting to find this Lubishan from Slough. And the guy, everyone to stop. And now one fellow says, come on, you follow me. And you follow me. And they say, now you carry on. I feel that they're right for people. You know, the thing is, this is you can change them for the better. With our gene, you can make them, you know, really thought bearers of light. They can do a better job than us. Once you convince them that this is the way, this is the solution to all the problems, and it is not here, the solution to all the problems. Give it to them. Share it with them. And in that process, that Allah will put you on. The details about your problem, I think you should discuss among your own brother, your brother.
Can I say a word referring to our brother,
sorry?
Our Muslim brother?
Well, it reminds me of the word.
It relates to the
soft.
Has a sister got a question? There is a microphone provided upstairs for sisters to ask questions.
Hello. Pratidhar, I wanted to let you to say that we should change the environment because the environment changes us. But the environment doesn't care anyway. Our children go to school. and you know, lead you to my religion. But faith is other people, the mothers, they don't care. We don't care if Jesus is God or not. We just live the life we want to live. And then, you know, our children say that, yes, it's better not to know the religion anyway. Nobody cares about religion anyway. How can we change these people?
I think in a nutshell the question was about the birth. The environment at school is Western. This can't be helped. You know, we can't change them to say, now look, we want everybody to wear Islamic dress or do this or do that. We can't. But see, the problem is at home, the parents. You know, they are not Islamically inclined. And I agree with my sister that that is the problem. The parents themselves are indifferent what happens. So for that, we have preached to them. And the best opportunity we have is Friday, Juma, we give the khutbah, stress this point, how that we can make Muslims better Muslims, that they can care for the children really Islamically, that once they do that, change the children, and the children, they will be able to change their fellow students. And so overall, we might be able to change the environment. It's something we have to try.
I will further quote this verse from Al Imran. This is regarding this day upon him and the invitation which was given through our Holy Prophet, this day upon him, to the Christians of that time. Inna masala bismillahi rahmani rahim. Inna masala isa indallahi kamasali adama kalakahu min turabin summa qala lahu kun fayakun. الحق من ربك فلا تكن من الممترين فمن هاجك فيه من بعد ما جاءك من العلم فقل تعالوا ندعو ابناءنا وابناءكم ونساءنا ونساءكم وانفسنا وانفسكم ثم نبتهل فنجعل لعنه الله على الكاذبين. The translation is the substitute of Jesus before God is as that of Adam. He created him from dust, then said to him, be, and he was. The truth comes from God alone, so be not of those who doubt. If anyone disputes in this matter with thee, now after good knowledge hath come to thee, say, come, let us gather together our sons and of your sons, our women and your women, ourselves and yourselves. Then let us earnestly pray and invoke the curse of God on those who die. I would like to ask Brother Didat that this invitation, which is in the shape of Mubala, this was given to our Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, and this invitation still exists in Quran. I would like to know that why the Muslim scholar, they put this challenge before the non-Muslim, the Christian.
The time and the occasion for the verse, the Shan and Nuzul, I take it is that the Christian deputation had come from Najran to Medina. They had heard that now an Arab is claiming to be in communication with Allah, claiming to be a prophet. So I said, let's go and cross-examine him. Let us see what he knows. And for 3 days and three nights, a dialogue took place between our Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the Christian. During the course of the dialogue, this is some of the things that happened. One is that they said that Jesus Christ is Allah's son because he's got no father. So Allah bari ta'ala gives by wahidu wa nabi to tell them, inna masala Isa inda Allahi kamasali Adam. The similitude or the example of Isa, Jesus, in the sight of Allah is like that of Adam. خَلَقَهُ مِنْ تُرَابٍ. He created him from dust. ثُمَّ قَالَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُنْ. And he said, be, and he was. In other words, if Jesus, because he had no earthly father, if that makes him God, or the veritable son of God, then Adam is a greater God, or a greater son of God. That was the logic. But the arguments continued, and the people started accusing them. The Christians started accusing our Nabi of falsehood,
that you are a liar, you are like this, you are like that.
Now when he reaches that stage, so for 3 days and three nights, it was a dialogue,
a discussion, which we are supposed to have.
Ya Allah kita ta'ala, come,
to what? A dialogue, a discussion.
But when he reached the stage of cursing, the guy started saying that, look, you are a liar, you are a cheat, you are an imposter. Now you reach a stage where you have to start now rolling up your sleeve.
So, our Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he wouldn't do that.
He said, look, if you accuse me of a liar,
there's no sense in me telling you, you are a liar. You say, I'm a liar. I said, the curse of God is in you. And you said, the curse of God is in you.
Let us now make a direct appeal to Allah to arbitrate in this dispute. So saying, he said, look, tomorrow morning, I will come with my family, and you come with your family, all of you, and we will invoke the curse of Allah upon whom he lies, he who lies. Say, Ya Bani Tala, if I'm a liar, destroy me. They say, look, Ya Bani Tala, if we are lying, destroy us. It has reached that pitch from a dialogue, a discussion, to a contest of cursing called Mubahila, from Munazira to Mubahila. So if you reach that stage, then there's only way out. If the man says, look, everything, nothing works, and the guys are cursing, abusing you, then God will destroy you. So well, then that man, you will pray to God to destroy who he lies, who lies. That is the difference. But we haven't even started the dialogue. When we're talking about cursing people, when we haven't opened your mouth, first open your mouth, put with us a video, see, invite all the ways of the Lord with wisdom, while mawqita al-hasanati, and with beautiful preaching, wa ja'alihum bilati ahsan, and reason with them, ways that are best and most gracious. Old Quran is the system Allah is teaching you how to do the job. If you have another occasion, I will tell you how the hikmah, how Allah does the job. I can carry on, hold you for another half an hour, but it's not fair to anybody, not to me. From this morning, I have been at it, you know, all over where I'm going. I came straight from somewhere, straight from the masjid. I want to go to the hotel, I have no time to go to the hotel. I just came straight here because circumstances for me. So there is a limit to what we can carry on, but this is the situation. The situation is, number one, you must start with a dialogue, a discussion. Long before you come to the stage of cursing. In this environment, in this day and age, you won't come to that stage. The guy will back out, you will back out, and say, man, I agree to disagree. If this is your way, love and deenukum waliyadeen. You come to that and say, you go your way, I go mine. As a last resort. Lakum deenukum waliyadeen. Your religion, you be mine. As a last resort. You will not come to this stage. But our Nabi, in that primitive time, the Christians, they provoked him to that. They said, all right, Allah says, then come, let's get together and let's invoke the curse of Allah upon him who lies. So that Mubahila is the last resort.
Could questioners please keep their questions short and simple? And the next question from sister, please.
Assalamu alaikum. Brother Bihar, I'd like to ask you something to do with questions. I know some Christians who are so convinced about Jesus' healing power that they have witnessed it in their own families, where somebody practically who is clinically dead was brought back to life, literally. They prayed to Jesus Christ, if you like, and you know, they claimed that it was due to his power that the child or whoever was so seriously ill was healed. Now, what sort of reply do I give to that Christian?
The question is that some Christians, somebody must have claimed that a person was clinically pronounced dead with all the instruments you have at your disposal, and somebody came along and prayed and the person came back to life, so that means now he's on the truth. That their religion is right because they have died. It says, now people like that, you tell them, what you're wasting your time with an individual, the hospitals are full of your brothers and sisters, go and heal them. What are you waiting for people to die and bring them back to life? The surgeons are doing it daily. People have been pronounced dead, certified dead, and they have been coming back to life. Again and again. Here in England, a man was certified dead. He had donated his kidneys, you know, to the kidney bank. But in England, in the UK, if before you can operate to extricate the organ, an organ, any organ, that person must be certified dead by two surgeons. And this individual was certified by two surgeons that he's dead as a dodo. So they took him to the operating table, the box. And the surgeon who was performing the operation to take out the kidneys, he puts the knife through his abdomen. And he hears a sigh. He's looking around at the message. Did you do that? Did you do that? He said, no. And the heart starts to palpitate and the man came back to life. Look, this knife did the job. Now what are you going to say? The knife is gone? No. Look, these things are happening daily. Daily they pronounce people dead. In the Food Steer Hospital in South Africa, you know, one of the most prominent hospitals in the country, where Chris Barnard operates, heart transplants, a white woman was certified dead, put into the mortuary, certified dead, next morning she comes out alive. Who performed the miracle? That's happening daily. These mistakes are being made. So somebody by the way comes along, says, wake up, and the guy wakes up, so what, I'm a god, what? It's a coincidence, things do happen. So tell them, you know, if they claim all these heavenly powers of healing people, they say, what do you wish to have? Go to the hospital and get them all out, all those people, people with hair, lip and clap, go on, do something for them. What are you wasting time running door to door? The patients are there waiting for you.
Now, the Christians claim that the Quran actually says that Jesus will die and will be raised unto life again in Surah Maryam, verse 33, which the translation of which follows as, so peace is on me the day that I was born, the day that I died, and the day that I shall be raised unto life again. What is your answer to that, please?
Now, the answer is straight, it's there. Allah is telling you, stands to reason what happened in the Royal Albert Hall was that this Arab Christian, he mistranslated that verse. See, the same fellow, Anish Sharosh, Dr. Sharosh, he had come along at the Royal Albert Hall, it's on tape, B19 tape, I think it's available there, where he comes along and he says, look, what have you to say? This is what he said.
If the Quran is indeed from God, does it contradict itself in as much as it says,
okay.
Mm-hmm. Therefore, Jesus was born, he died, and he rose again.
So, wa salamun alayya yawma wulidtu. You spoke like an Arab. I don't speak like an Arab. But it's wa salamun alayya yawma wulidtu wa yawma amutu wa yawma huwa suhayya. This is translated, so peace is on me, the day that I was born, the day that I died, and the day that I shall be raised to life again. As an Arab, you have known better than that. But the answer was, I reread the verse and I told him then,
which translated means, so peace is on me, the day that I was born, the day that I die, and the day that I shall be raised to life again. The day that I die, it is not that I died. It's not died, it's in the future.
So we believe that there will be a day that the Isa alayhi salam must die. Allah says that every soul must taste of death. Every soul, Jesus must also, he must taste of death, and Allah brings him back to life again. This is our belief with regard to all human beings. Everybody must die, and everybody must be raised to life again. Not excluding Jesus.
Can a sister ask a question, please? Salaam alaikum. Brother Ahmed, what does the Bible say about the rights of women, and how does this compare with those in Islam? And if they compare well, how do you answer some of the allegations made by some Christians?
For example, what allegations?
They say that Muslims mistreat women, and their women are covered, and such allegations.
A very generalized question. You see, the person tells you something specific. Mistreat women. The Europeans. Are they all treating the women well? Are they? No. You know, because, you know, what's happening? Not leave out the women, their own children.
They're committing incest with their own children. 8% of all wives in South Africa, they commit incest with their own daughters, not stepdaughters. 8%. So what are you talking about? The wife says, what are you talking about? You have a right to point a finger and ask. You, last June, 300,000 sodomites, you call them gay. They gathered in San Francisco in a pilgrimage, led by 50 lesbians on motorcycles. You have a right to point a finger and ask. When I came one of my previous trips, 8,000 gays, they get in Hyde Park, selling the wares, trying to tell people that there's something wrong with you, you should be like them, you have a right to point a finger at us. You have a surplus of women, there are 3 million more English women than men. If every man in England got married, there'll be 3 million women who can't get husbands. It's a fine solution for them. In New York, your Christian nation, New York, there are 1 million more women than men. If every man in New York gets married, there will be 1 million women in New York who can't get husbands. I'm telling my Arab brother, go there. And then there's 4 at a time. Bring them back 4 at a time. You can't propagate your tongue through the mouth. Go and marry them and take them and get every year 4, 4, 4. And of the manpower that they have there, 1/3 are gay, 1/3 are gay. Sodomites, 1/3. See the problem? Catamites and sodomites, 1/3. You have a right to point a finger at us. This filthy, dirty thing, sodomy, you call it. What a beautiful world, you're prostituting. You know, when I was born, I was supposed to go to school, I should learn sing songs. The teachers said, gentle lords and ladies gay, on the mountain dawns the day. Ladies gay, happy and gay, happy and good, and say happy good luck. He said, very gay, happy and gay. It was a beautiful world, happy and gay. Now he said, yeah, happy and gay. You have a right to point a finger at us. Yes, I don't know why you apologize. For what? Oh, you people are allowed to have more than one wife. Yes. After four. Allah tells us in the Holy Quran, say marry women of your choice, by 2s and 3s and 4s, but if you cannot do justice between them, marry only one. The only religious book on the face of the earth which has an expression, marry only one, is the Quran. There's no other book on earth which says marry only one. There are problems in society where it has become necessary for a man to take on extra responsibility. Like after wars, other national reasons, calamities, there are times when a man must take on extra responsibility. And I'm reading news, dateline from London, again and again, that a man is charged with bigamy in your country. Bigamy. Bigamy is having more than one wife, two. So the law says he was one of them or go to jail. Both the women said, look, leave us alone, we are happy with the man. The law says, no, he was one of them or go to jail. There's something wrong with your brain. Something wrong with you. Look, your law allows sodomy. Homosexuality is legal. It's legalized. Lesbianism is legalized. But the most natural thing, polygamy, he says, oh, my dead body, you won't have it. You will put the man in jail. He can be getting a dozen illegitimate for children every year. You call it a stat. He's a great guy. You have a right to polygamy like us? So now look, why are you apologetic? Soon after the war, I think this is the last question. Please sit down. Soon after the war, soon after the war, you know, the last Second World War, I'm reading another news item, Dateline from London. It said, 5,000 misfits to be shipped to America. That's the headline, 5,000 misfits to be shipped to America. And the human mind is very imaginative. You think when you read that, you get the whole idea of what the whole thing is about. That's what I thought. I was thinking that perhaps America medically is more advanced than England. So they must be sending the cripples, the people with hairless and club foot for treatment in America. You know the headline, 5,000 misfits to be shipped to America. But when I read further, it revealed to me that these 5,000 misfits were the offsprings of Negro soldiers stationed on the west coast of England during the war. Please, sit down. They were offsprings of Negro soldiers stationed England during the war. That they were too black to be absorbed into English society. You know, with crinkly hair, with little stump nose, and high cheekbones. If your sister had one of those, and everybody coming by, said, what's this? So my sister Mary's child. And so what's this? So my sister Mary's child. How do you do? Horrible. She said, you ship them all to America. So I'm asking them the question. The Western asking. Said, how many Negro soldiers were there compared to the whites in the UK, in your Great Britain? How many compared to the white Australians? The white New Zealander, the white South African, the white Canadian, the white American, the white Free French, the white Free Pole, who? Compared to the British soldier. How many blacks were there compared to the whites? Negligible. Compared to the whites? Negligible number of Negro soldiers. Then again, they were taught given lessons in prophylactics to avoid pregnancy, to avoid disease. And we know that every arrow doesn't hit the mark, nor is every prayer granted. What amount of mischief was done in Christian England to produce those 5,000 misfits? Can you imagine? And you have a right to point a finger at us? You? I don't know why you should apologize for anything. What you can apologize for? There's nothing you have to apologize for. Allah. Yes, go ahead. Come on, man. Tell what you want to know. This is the teaching. What have you got? You've got nothing. There's nothing you can tell yourself one that Christ died for your sins. He can't teach you hygiene, he can't teach you ethics, he can't teach you morality, there's nothing he can teach you, nothing. What are you going to apologize for? What are you going to apologize for? What are you going to apologize for? What? I said, go to town with them, man. This is the destiny. Allah said, he is a hero for nothing in a bullet.